soul that deserves and is capable of receiving the message and receiving the higher levels of guidance, they looked at their bodies and the bodies of the messengers, and they said, you're like us. If you could receive a message, we could receive a message. Since we did not receive a message, you did not receive a message. That's basically their argument. And they went to the next level and they started threatening them. And if you do not stop, we will stone you, we will harm you, we will bring very painful and severe punishments upon you. The news reached the outskirts of the city, so this man who believed and was blessed to see beyond the physical appearance of the messengers, in fact, he may not have seen them physically, but he heard of people who are speaking of a high level of faith, believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in a God that is not seen, believing in a power beyond these idols that people ascribe partners to him. In fact, most of the people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of the idol worshippers in the Holy Quran, most of them, they do believe in the Creator. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives an example, وَلَا إِنْ سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ لَيَقُولُنَّ اللَّهُ. If you ask them, this is from the Holy Quran, if you ask them who created the heavens and the earth, they say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what about these idols that you ascribe partners? Oh, we worship them only to get close to God. Or others believe that some of them have certain powers, that one was in charge of one aspect of sustenance, another was in charge of one aspect of, you know, good life, longevity, this, that, and the other. And therefore we go to them for these things. And they can do it besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Min dunillah. That is the key that they basically, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whenever anybody spoke of any shufa'a, any intercessors, any wasila or any shafa'a, whenever anyone spoke of it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, how can they do anything without Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Min dunillah. If we consider that Ahlul Bayt sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have a place with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a very special position, and therefore he, out of their the love and the maqam that they have, the status that they have, he gives them a special status that if you beseech him with their name, it is more likely that it would be considered. That is not thinking that they can do anything without Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is something we need to be very clear. That if it is not with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it won't happen. If it's not in line with obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it won't happen either. Therefore, I mentioned to Muminin that if somebody thinks that I can go to ziyarah of Imam Hussein alayhi salam or come to the majlis of Imam Hussein alayhi salam and get hajat and get shafa'a, when they neglect their duty with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for example, if they're neglectful of salat or neglectful of other duties that they have, other obligations that they have with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are mistaken. Imam Sadr alayhi salam clearly stated in his last will, in fact, he says, La ilaha shafa'atu. One who is undermining the value of salat will not receive our intercession. So this is clear that it is not min dunillah, it is not in the opposite direction. One goes in the direction of shaytan and then beseeching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or shufa'a ila Allah. It doesn't work. In any case, these people had their idols. This man had understood that the messengers are speaking he could see beyond the appearance of a human being who is guiding me. Who is he? He's a human being. He realized that yes, a human being, but with a purified soul, could see. Now, what does it take to get that level of guidance? It takes purification. And that is why whenever we go to any ziyarah, hajj, umrah, any a'mal even, time or place, we have certain special times for ibadah and worshiping. We have special places for ibadah and worshiping. Asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you want to gain something really good for these nights, the very first thing we need to do is istighfar. Seek forgiveness. Admit our fault, seek forgiveness with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Purify the soul, purify the nafs, so that we can be recipients of His further guidance, of levels and levels of guidance. Many people, it's not by studying, believe me. You know, seeking knowledge is not difficult. Seeking information, let's say. I'm not talking about, you know, the aql and the opposite of aql. Increasing in aql is increasing in the direction to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But increasing in information is not difficult. One can study one way or another. Nowadays it's much easier. You have, in fact, even Islamic studies, not speaking of other fields of science also, it's not that difficult. One can spend time and do it. Even Islamic studies, even theories of sayr and suluk, the theories of how do I get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The theory is easy to study. You know, you grab some books, you grab some ahadith in that regard, and you coming to the level that certain awliya Allah reached, how many do reach? Amongst thousands and thousands of students of even Islamic seminary, only few of them become al-Qur'an. Not many become. Why? It requires a lot of purification. It requires tazkiyah. Qad aflaha man zakkaha. Seeking knowledge with tazkiyah. One of the beautiful poems from a great scholar, he says, your effort should be in removing the veils, not in collecting books that are raft, because with collecting books you will never be able to remove the veils. Removing the veils to see things for what they really are requires purification. Requires one to seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to purify, to realize the faults and the errors of the nafs, to look at the nafs and scrutinize it, criticize it. If I have any levels of jealousy in me, if I have any levels of arrogance in me, unless I purify from those diseases of the soul, I will not be able to get to the next level. One of the ways we can train in tazkiyah is our own family relationships. That is why we tazawwaja faqad ahaza. That's for the evening. Whoever gets married has completed half of their religion. Why? Because through those relationships and one purifying within those relationships, they can reach. One of my teachers used to say, if you want to know someone is really adil, you know, in terms of Imam Jama'ah, ask their wife. Not to ask about the opposite, because, you know, she's angry, he becomes non-adil immediately. But if she testifies, if a wife testifies that he is adil, be it known that he is really adil. But she knows him very close. She sees him, she knows him. That those relationships, within those relationships, we purify. Therefore, we get to a higher level. Then we have a better vision. Then we can see people they couldn't see. One of the, so in terms of relationships, we need to make sure we get rid of jealousy, we get rid of arrogance. Otherwise, we will not be able to see more guidance and seek higher levels of hidayah and guidance. That's one. The other one is detachment from dunya. Tazkiyah, part of it is to detach from worldly things. As long as ukhlida ila al-ard, as long as one is stuck to earth, he thinks that this is who I am. Like these people, they thought my body is like the body of the Prophet or the messengers, therefore we are the same. They didn't recognize who they really are. They thought they were this body. And all they cared about are the needs of this body. Imam Hadi alayhi salam, in his poem that he says to Mutawakkil when he was brought to that gathering and the curse Mutawakkil was drinking and so on. He says, you know, where are these kings and their castles, the past kings? He says, where are these faces that they used to take very good care of? You know, when we look at the face and the head is actually the most valuable part of the body. And the face to us, it is almost like this is me. Or what if they do the face change nowadays? They ask me, what happens? This is no longer me. So am I really this face? He says, where are these faces that أَيْنَ الْوُجُوهُ الَّتِي كَانَتْ مُنَعَمَةً. They used to put all these different creams and shade, make sure nothing changes, nothing happens, and everything is pure, and no wrinkles, and where are they? He says, now these same faces, the wounds are fighting over them in their graves. SubhanAllah, that even that enemy of God, even Mutawakkil, and his people were all in tears hearing the words of the Imam. Did it change them? That's a different thing. They could see that, they feared that position, but their attachments and perhaps their diseases did not allow them to purify. The Imam is there. We often would love to have a side of our Imam. The Imam is there talking to them, guiding them, and they could not be guided. This man, he hears, he rushes. One of the characteristics that our scholars, they say in Aqsa al-Madina, in the outskirts of the city, is that people are living humbly. Oftentimes, the center is the expensive, you know, the main marketplace, whoever lives around there is typically the wealthier, the more affluent, and so on. The outskirts, typically, they are the more humble. If one does not detach from dunya, is attached to dunya and its belongings and all the things that we consider valuable in this dunya, again, guidance is not easy for such people. This man comes willing to sacrifice, putting himself in a very, very difficult position, very dangerous situation, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes him first as rushing, coming with a lot of effort, yes, and then he started speaking all different or using all different arguments and means to guide his own people, these people that were denying and threatening the messengers, supporting and helping the messengers, and he was not, definitely was not a messenger from God. Therefore, it is not limited to them. And when we hear the description that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives, we realize how valuable it is for us to make them such efforts. He came, he says, Ya Rabbi, my people. He's making that emotional connection. Oh, my people, follow the messengers. Immediately, he's telling them they are messengers. Messengers means they are being sent by somebody. اتبعوا, we mentioned that he used the argument that they're not asking you for a reward. اتبعوا من لا يسألكم أجرا. Follow them because they're not asking for a reward. If they had any worldly benefits, you could question. They're asking you for some wealth, some money, you know, give us money will guide you. They're not asking you for that. اتبعوا من لا يسألكم أجرا. And look at them, how they are guided themselves, their lifestyle, the way they are. They're honest people, they're good people. You would love to be around them. Now that they're giving you a message, saying, with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam,
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد وجل.
And you are returning to him. وَإِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ. Not only that, he is also speaking of the time that we're in this world. I mentioned the hadith of Amir al-Mu'mineen, the three stages. Where from, where to, where in. أَعْبُدُ. While we're in this world, our obligation, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسِ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. عِبَادَةً. Our purpose here is ibadah. Our livelihood is guaranteed. Our sustenance is guaranteed. ما أريد منهم رزقا. I don't expect, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us in the Holy Quran, He's not expecting you to basically worry about sustenance for Him or even sustenance for yourself based on the different tafasir. Sustenance is guaranteed. Yes, we have to work. Not that we sit and do nothing. No. We make our effort. No, don't make that your focus in life. Livelihood, home, and what we eat and where we live. All of this is not even in my control. I do my part, but عرفتُ اللهَ بِحَسْبِ. It says, I know God through the breaking of the very strong wills and plans. When you have the intention, after you've planned everything, everything is going well, you have that strong azima, and it doesn't happen. I know that God is the one who is planning. If we recognize that, then don't you make your effort. Focus on your ibadah. Then he says, أَأَتَّخِذُ مِنْ دُونِهِ آلِهَةً. Idols. Should I consider and worship gods besides him, min dunihi? That's the key. Alihata. These people, they thought there are gods for different things. And obviously they believed in the Creator. They spoke of the Creator. They told their messengers. وَمَا أَنزَلَ الرَّحْمَنُ. In fact, some of our Mufassirin, our greatest scholars, they say that their faith was the Rahman is the highest God. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He introduces Himself to us, He says, Bismillah Rahman. Why? Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam explains, he says, even the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a follower of His mercy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not punish out of vengeance. I'm going to take revenge of you. You did not. Never. Even His punishment is part and parcel of His mercy. That is part of His adl, part of His mercy, part of His process of purifying those who went into certain paths And that purification happens at different levels. It could happen in dunya, it could happen in barzakh, it could happen in akhirah. Depends on how far they have transgressed. He says, وَمَا لِيَ لَا أَعْبُدُ الَّذِي فَطَرَنِي وَإِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ أَأَتَّخِذُ مِن دُونِهِ آلِهَةً. Here he is clarifying that don't think that there is the Rahman and there are other gods. No. It's all in his control. It's all in God's control. أَيُّرِدْنِ الرَّحْمَانُ. He clarifies here. أَأَتَّخِذُ مِن دُونِهِ آلِهَةً. Should I? How would I, or why would I consider any gods besides him when إِن يُرِدْنِ الرَّحْمَانُ بِشَيْءٍ, if the Rahman decrees something for me, good or bad, the intercession of all these other idols will not change anything. إِن يُرِدْنِ الرَّحْمَانُ بِشَيْءٍ لَا تُغْنِ عَنِّي شَفَاعَتُهُمْ شَيْئًا. وَلَا يُنْقِذُونَ. Their intercession will not do anything for me, will not benefit me in any regard. If God decrees, there's nothing that they could do. And they cannot save me from Him. He is the creator. He is, in other words, the sustainer. And He is the owner of the day of judgment. They cannot do shafa'ah for sustenance, for anything here. And they cannot save me on the day of judgment. It's all. They cannot do anything. Then he says that path, he's reminding them now and showing them what is the real guidance and what is the real misguidance. The messengers, وَهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ. They're guided. In their lifestyle, they're guided. And in their faith, they're guided. And on the other hand, he says, if I do that, if I ascribe partners in me, then لَفِي ضَلَالٍ. I then would definitely be in great error. I will be on the wrong path, astray, clearly. ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. Then he declares his faith. Differences whether he declared to the messengers or whether he declared to the people, there's a bit of a difference. إِنِّي آمَنْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ فَاسْمَعُونَ. Some say that he said إِنِّي آمَنْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ to the messengers, فَاسْمَعُونَ to the people. Some say he said إِنِّي آمَنْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ فَاسْمَعُونَ to the people. And some say he said both statements to the messenger. Regardless, basically the difference is one is he's giving the testimony of faith in your Lord, بِرَبِّكُمْ, to the messengers. Why? Because he wouldn't say بِرَبِّكُمْ to the idol worshippers, because they ascribe partners for God. Their Rabb may not be the one God. However, others say that's still possible because he is telling them he is your Lord, not just the messengers, not just myself. It's still possible that he was addressing the people, and فَاسْمَعُونَ was his shahada, his testimony of faith, that cost him his life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala immediately afterwards, so people could not stand it, he is the first target, according to the narrations, and based on the ayah, how it's that the tone of the ayah immediately, saying, قيل ادخل الجنة. It is said to him, enter paradise. Jannah here, Jannah al-Barzakh. In Barzakh, it's Jannah. Imma hufratun min hufar al-Niran, or rawdatun min riyad al-Jannah. He immediately was permitted and admitted to the Rawda of Riyad al-Jannah, the garden. Al-Mufassirin, they say no pain of the death, no, you know, ihtidar, and all that pain, all of the difficulties of that stage, that last stage, and Furuj al-Ruh, and how difficult it is, and the first night of Qabr, and Naqtatul Qabr, you know, that prayer. pressure, none of that he experienced. Immediately it is said to him, he becomes a martyr, and how easy is the path for him when you put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and do whatever you can do in terms of your ibadah, especially at that level of ibadah, in terms of guiding others without any fear, only to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He grants him this status, that he becomes amongst the mukrameen. Inshallah, if we have the chance, I will mention that last part of that ayah, that he sees how, where he is and how he is, and he says, Ya Layta Qawmi, that we often say, Ya Laytana Kunna Ma'akum Fanafuza Fawzan Azima. He says, Ya Layta, I wish you were with me. And this is the reality of it. It is them who wish for us to be with them, for us to have that wish in the first place. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us to be with them.